for now. We got a walk-on guest, Neville Gallimore, straight to the set, live. Here he is. What's going on, Neville? Mike Florio, great to meet you. From the podium to live TV and radio, how's it going?
It's going well so far.
You got a good story. You're Canadian.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Ottawa. How cold is it getting in Ottawa this time of year?
February, you're probably looking at probably the coldest time, you know, negative 20 degrees kind of being like your typical day.
What led you to football growing up in Canada?
I come from a basketball family, and, you know, I just kind of remember, you know, playing basketball, shooting hoops, you know, in the park one day, and I seen a, you know, group of guys who are now my friends, you know, just playing football, attacking each other, you know, playing on the grass, you know, just kind of having a good time, nobody getting in trouble and stuff. And so I joined the party and then fell in love with the game ever since.
Would you feel like it was like a magnet? You felt it like pull you over toward that group?
Literally, I felt like I just needed to be there. And it's funny because I'm really not the, I'm not the kind of guy to just, you know, go out of my way, especially it wasn't just like one or two guys. There's probably like 10 guys there. I'm just like, you know, like, what are they doing? I kind of started to gravitate towards them. And they're like, hey, like, come over. Like, come here. Like, come play. It's like they try to, you know, test me like that. So I did that, and then it just kind of took off from there.
I have a feeling none of those other guys are going to be in the NFL. Is that safe to say?
No, those guys are working hard and doing their thing.
It's just weird how your destiny kind of unfolds. When did you realize that you weren't just interested in playing football, but you're going to be pretty good at it?
I feel like, you know, like ninth grade, when I was like, it's more than just, you know, a love for this game. It's like a passion, and there's an opportunity. I feel like, you know, I could change my life. I remember, you know, that's why I feel like I was destined for this, but also just even the school I went to, you know, I always had a dream of playing at University of Oklahoma, and it really came that ninth grade. I remember even being in that summer with a few of my best friends, we watching ESPN All Access, and I was just being a Canadian kid, especially from Ottawa, a place where it's even more rare for guys, you know, to get an opportunity to play Division I football, especially at a Power 5 school. You know, I was just sitting there watching ESPN All Access. I was like, man, like, how cool to be if that was me in that position.
What was the hardest part, though, of the transition from Ottawa to Oklahoma?
Again, you know, just the caliber of football that was being played, you know, the level of competition, the expectation, you know, it's just, again, it's night and day. Like, the amount of time, you know, just the amount of things that are invested in football, you know, in America compared to, you know, what I was used to. So, you know, adjusting, you know, going from barely having a playbook to having, like, you know, and then just running around being a hire for God to having to do things within the confines of the system. I really had to become a student of the game.
What was the difference for you in the size of your classes, the size of your school, going from Ottawa to a major university like Oklahoma?
So I went to Canada Prep Academy my junior and senior year, and, you know, graduating with a class of like probably like 8 guys. You know, the school probably had 30 guys, you know, and then to going to Oklahoma where school population like 35,000, you know, going into a class where I think you probably got maybe, you know, 40, 50 guys if you include everybody, you know, the walk-ons, you know, all the scholarship guys. So it was different. But I enjoyed it because I loved Oklahoma, the tradition, and then just the fact that I was a part of like a football town. And I wanted to get that full, you know, football experience, but also have a home away from home.
Now, you grew up in Canada, and NBCSN has a lot of the NHL games.
Right.
You got to be a hockey fan.
Ottawa Senators, you know, that's my city. I was never really a good skater, but, you know, got love for hockey.
You still a Senators fan? It's kind of hard to be a Senators fan.
I'm a Senators fan. That's my city, though.
That's good. Got to be true to the city. Die hard with the Ottawa Senators. On the field, I suspect you faced more than a few double teams, right? How do you react when you've got multiple guys that you got to deal with? Because I'd be frustrated. It seems like it's not fair. Give me a one-on-one. I don't want to have two guys trying to block me. What do you do when you face that?
I mean, you know, the one thing that I understand, and I feel like every interior defensive lineman, you know, probably, you know, can attest to this, but I feel like, you know, my job is to do the dirty work. So I know if I'm commanding double teams, that means I know there's got to be a gap or somewhere free for the linebacker to come make a play. So, I mean that's why you play this game. And if you're doing your job, that's what's expected. And, you know, obviously, you know, sometimes, you know, you want to be in a position to make the play. But I feel like, you know, when you look at the great defensive linemen, you know, at the NFL, They're still making plays with a double, whether they got a double team on them or not. So that's where I'm trying to also take that next step. But you know, I had quite a few of them. So
who do you pattern your game after that's currently in the NFL?
Like I mentioned before, there's three guys that come to mind. You know, you think of the likes of Geno Atkins, you know, Timmy Jernigan, Jarrell Casey, just because, you know, similar build in terms, you know, high in weight, but guys just do both. You know, they're the most consistent, I feel like, you know, just doing both really well, strong at the point of attack and can rush the passer.
Who's done the most to help you develop the technique that you need to make it in the NFL?
You know, I got to give a, you know, shout out to my D-line coach, you know, Coach Calvin Thibodeau. Definitely helped me grow a lot as a player, especially in terms of, like, my mental toughness. He was a guy that understood that, you know, I had a long ways to go in terms of being a student of the game. But, you know, really appreciate the fact that, you know, he's never given up on me. He's always pushed me past limits that I never thought I could get to or get past to. But, you know, just understanding that even now, as the game finally starting to slow down for me, you know, I feel like my best football is still ahead of me.
You've gotten an up-close look at Joe Burrow, the LSU quarterback, who's likely going to be the first pick in the draft. What was your take on him as a player?
I mean, it's one thing, you know, to see it on film. You know, he did a lot of amazing things, but, you know, when you got a chance to experience, you know, up close, personal, you know, you get to see, you know, he's a real deal. He's no fluke to see the things he's done. You know, he's worked hard, and even, you know, his grind to go from where he was before to, you know, to get to LSU and have a season, yeah, you know, that's definitely, you know, credit to him and the work he's put in. So, you know, definitely, you know, shout out to him.
The guy who was the first pick last year, your former teammate at Oklahoma, Kyler Murray. We had Cliff Kingsbury, his NFL coach, with us the other day, and Kingsbury and I both agree that Murray could be the guy this year, the guy who makes the big jump, the guy who takes the NFL by storm. What are your memories of seeing that guy on the practice field?
I had the opportunity to, you know, to practice against, you know, some great quarterbacks, you know, apart from Kyler Murray, you know, Baker Mayfield, Jalen Hurts, but, you know, Kyler Murray is a special player. You know, I feel like, you know, obviously the things that he can do with his feet, you know, you haven't seen anything, rarely have you seen anything like it, but, you know, I feel like a lot of people don't really haven't taken notice, and they will, you know, what he can do with that arm. And he's a playmaker. He's a playmaker, and he's a competitor. I haven't seen too many guys that, you know, compete like him, so he's going to dominate. I know when he gets that opportunity, that next year, you know, this upcoming season, he's going to turn some heads, just like he already has.
For a guy that little, the ball just explodes out of his hand,
yeah,
and it explodes into the hands of the receivers, doesn't it? It's amazing to see a guy that small throw the ball that way.
Yeah, size, you know, small in stature, but he plays big. Yeah.
Now, you may be his teammate, or you may be chasing him around eventually. We're going to find out. That's the beauty of the draft. We don't know.
Hey,
Neville Gallimore, great talking to you. We wish you all the best this week at the Combine and beyond.
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.